speaker today, Penny Abernathy. I know some of you know her. Penny brought her class. So I want you all to know, students, that now you get to ask her a lot of hard questions. So, you know, go for it. I'm sure she won't hold a grudge. Come great time. Penny is a person who has had more than 30 years of experience as a reporter and editor and a media executive. And before she came here, I always thought of her as our graduate who knew the most about, or our friend of our school who knew the most about the business side of the media business. Now she sits in our night chair in journalism and digital media economics, a position she's held since 2008. Penny is a native of Laurinburg, North Carolina, and once worked for the Laurinburg Exchange newspaper. She's the fastest talking person ever you'll have been from Laurinburg, I'm sure. More importantly, perhaps, she's a former executive at the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times. She was vice president and executive director of industry programs at the Paley Center for Media in New York City. As a media executive, she has launched new enterprises, helped increase revenue at some of the nation's most prominent news organizations. And she knows the business inside out, and that's why we hired her. She has a bachelor's degree from the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, and two master's degrees, one of which is an MBA. And both of those master's degrees are from Columbia. Yeah, in 1998, we wisely inducted her into the North Carolina Journalism Hall of Fame. And she lives down the hall from me. Thank you, Penny.
Thank you, Kathy. Kathy and I actually crossed paths back in the 70s, right, Kathy and Charlie?
I don't remember the 70s.
Maybe it was the
90s. No, I do, because Don was my advisor.
And Don was my teacher when I was here, too. He was the last one left from that era, too. Thank you a lot, Kathy, for this. I had attached another little line to what I sent Tree, and I wanted to talk today about some of the research that I've done in the last 2 years that I've been here. And I'm really excited about it for a couple of reasons. One is I did start out at the Laurinburg Exchange. My husband and I managed to work at just about every newspaper in North Carolina before we left 35 years ago. I hit the Fayetteville Times, I hit the Greensboro paper, and the Charlotte Observer. He hit the Charlotte News, the Winston-Salem paper, and the Fayetteville paper, and the Raleigh News Observer, which was news editor for him. Saw the light, decided to become an Episcopal priest somewhere in Wichita, America. So we have a strong background and feel like we were really nurtured in, as journalists here in North Carolina. So there's a real strong commitment in coming back here to wanting to really provide practical research that can be used by newspapers immediately and also that can be put into use and help them get through this very difficult time. So, and then the second reason I'm really excited about what's happened here is because of the strong foundation of research that was laid, the foundation that was laid by Don, among others, but also Maxwell McCombs and Phil Meyer, both on the agenda-setting research that's been done here, on a lot of the good work that both Maxwell Combs and Don did on economics. There's an excellent article I'm going to refer to that in the course of doing one of the papers for Yale, I unearthed that was a great, very prescient piece done back in 1991 by Don for the University of Indiana there. And so it's just really nice to both combine agenda setting, the vanishing newspaper, the theory of relative constancy, which I'll talk about a little bit more in just a few minutes, with the research that's ongoing today and going forward. So it builds very nicely on a legacy that was left and created here, and also I feel good because I am contributing back to the newspapers that really helped me get off the ground and on the way back several years ago. What I want to do today, I'm talking about surviving the economic creative destruction, and that actually comes from the Austrian economist Joseph Schumpeter. It was one of those things when I first started talking about creative destruction 4 or 5 years ago, you would know that immediately the next day you would get an email from somebody who would had probably just been laid off at a newspaper and remind you that he was very anti-union, he was all sorts of vile things. He was, of course, a true capitalist. And what Joseph Schumpeter basically looked at creative destruction as being the economic force that shuffled the economic deck and allowed capitalism to renew itself each year. Now, that doesn't mean that capitalism doesn't come with some sort of destruction, and it usually comes with the destruction of an existing or a legacy business for that. But nowadays, whenever I go to a conference, when we went to Yale, I started counting the number of times somebody mentioned creative destruction. It's so commonly talked about now. People debate whether you can have a creative destruction. He originally meant it for a business, but whether you can have it in an industry or whether you can have it in it can actually have an industry recreate itself, very appropriate when we talk about what's going to happen to the newspaper industry. So one of the things I first start with is there's a lot of misinformation that's out there, and whenever I talk, I tend to group the initial reactions I have into one of two categories. There's something I call the Chicken Little approach. It basically deals with the destructive part of creative destruction, and it's one of those where we run around saying the sky is falling down, it's all over, Google has won, there's no use even playing the game. The other one is the mad scientist approach that basically says all we need to do is just be a little bit more innovative and creative, and the answers will come in due time. I've actually been fascinated by this since the early 90s and started working on it a lot when I was at the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal, and it tended to group into three categories. The first was media brands matter in a digital age, and how do you engender customer loyalty or brand loyalty in this age? The second had to do with how convergence is changing consumption of news from one generation to the next. Now, we have a great, Don and I were discussing that this morning, we have a great trend line going on right now with Pew. What I really like is some of the recent surveys that have begun to track by generation and differentiating between Gen Xers, Gen Yers, and baby boomers. And then the last is the notion of how do you lead a journalistic institution during a time of creative destruction? And how do you know if you're even winning as you're fighting the battle of creative destruction? That actually, I had a long time fascination with it, but when I was down here interviewing for the job, Don asked the really sticky question where he actually put faces on the names of some of the leaders to ask me if I thought, for instance, Punch Sulzberger would have handled this any better than his son Arthur had handled the creative destruction going through the newsroom right now. And of course, the other thing I had to defend until recently, I haven't had to defend this a lot in the last year or two, is why journalists should care about any of this. I mean, this is all the type of stuff you usually relegated to the marketing department. And as Kathy says, I am bilingual. I did tend to start out in journalism and go over to the other side. And the very reason you do is because what has sustained good journalism in the last half of at least the 20th century was what was called a virtuous circle versus the vicious cycle. The virtuous circle being that you got an involved audience, you were able to premium price your advertising, and in turn you took the premium prices that you charged for your advertising and reinvested it in your news. On the brand loyalty, I basically had a lot of interest around something that started back in the early 1990s. One of the nice things about how things developed on a business side is that you had consulting firms. As I mentioned to folks who were taking my leadership class, the notion of strategy is actually very, very recent in business history. If you look at it, strategy was something that was done by sports teams and by army generals, but it's only been since the 1960s, 1970s that you really had some kind of notion of what business strategy was. And it's been even more recent that you've had the consulting firms who've actually started doing some of the academic research that was quantifiable research that was originally done by academia. One of the more fascinating people I came across in the early 90s was a guy who was at Bain. And Bain, before it came in here and got known for cost-cutting, used to be the most creative of the consulting firms, and they used to have a publish-or-perish notion. You had to pick something you were really interested in, you had to publish. They published a lot of good books. Starting in the early 90s, Fred Rockhill wrote something called The Loyalty Effect, and it was back during a time when everybody thought brands were dead. It didn't matter whether you were a newspaper or whether you were a cigarette company, your brand was dead. And he actually started saying, you know, we've been measuring this all wrong. You don't look at customer satisfaction. You look at how loyal people are. And he really struggled for the one question he could ask people that would predict whether they were going to be loyal or not. He went through about 80-some-odd questions, Bain financing this to the tune of several million dollars. refining it. He got it down to three. He refined it some more, and finally got it down in the early turn of the century, to the ultimate question. The ultimate question is, on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being highest, would you recommend to a friend or colleague? And from that, he predicted that he said you could predict with about 87% certainty whether a company would be profitable or not. So you think about it for a minute. What he's actually doing is looking at straight down to the bottom line on this, because good customers are going to buy more, they're going to pay more, they're also going to sell more for you. So that's really the basis of what all that is. And from that, I've had my own set of questions. It's called a net promoter score. You take the number of people who actually are going to recommend you versus those who are detracting from you, and to see what kind of net promoter score you've got. This has been done by enough companies now that you can figure out where you stand in your industry as well as where you stand with a general sense of how loyal companies are in general in the U.S. I'm curious what the role of social networks is in this going forward. I'm curious about the window of opportunity. One of the things that we've done when we've looked at it at various papers is found that there's a window of opportunity for you when you introduce somebody to a brand. So for the New York Times, that has historically been between the ages of 18 and 26, and it's usually a college professor says to you, or somebody else you admire, that's usually a college professor at that time, who says if you want to be well-read, you need to read the New York Times. I remember exactly what college professor said that to me. I think it'll be really interesting to see whether that holds up in this era where people are not actually reading the printed product. And then, you know, how the millennials distinguish among the various emerging brands online, and what draws them to affiliate. And then, of course, the role of journalism and credibility. On convergence, one of the things that I ask the class in the beginning of every semester is how 5 years from now we're going to be able to tell the website of a newspaper from that of a video. Our television station. I think it's a very interesting thing if you look at what is the difference between a newspaper and a magazine, as you have newspapers cutting back. This convergence raises a whole range of issues of how you look at the various media that are out there. One of the interesting things that fell out of a survey done by Deloitte back in 2002 was that across the board, whether you were a baby boomer, whether you were a Gen Y or a Gen Xer, they tended to be exceedingly loyal to magazines. It plays into something that Don had talked about, and that's the paper that I'm going to talk about in just a minute, about finding your niche and really having loyal people bring you in into a kind of a social network. How fast their reading habits and viewing habits are changing. How does each generation use the various mediums? And this is the one that I found most interesting. And part of it is, I guess, you always relate to what you know best. I have a 31-year-old son and a 21-year-old son. And one of the things that I notice is that they both can sit there and play video games, or they both seem to be interested in the same sorts of movies, but they consume news very, very differently. And one of the things that those who've been tracking the various generations point out is there's a break somewhere around age 25 as to how people consume how they consume both information, how they consume information differently. And then, of course, how do you lead in a journalistic age? A number of questions that come out of that one. The last one being how the economics are different, understanding how the economics are different, how you take advantage of the new economics to position your brand for growth. Digital media economics, what I've tried to do is break down numbers into a word concept, because we all know we're journalists and we'd rather really not deal with numbers if we don't have to. And what we've done is talk about a strategy framework in which we look at three components. The first is the firm. And from that, I ask the basic question, who are we? I've got these up here, and I'll pass those around. It's just that it looks on the surface to be a very simple set of questions. I'll go over that in just a minute.
This is the same thing you said to the email.
Yes, it is.
Sleep forward
yeah, thank you. Yes, let's don't kill another tree if we don't have to. We don't want Bang coming back to us.
I saw that.
Yeah. cycle being the typical economic cycle that newspapers, television typically live through versus the cyclone being the notion that was articulated by Dick Foster up at Yale at the time he was at McKinsey, in which he talked about that in addition to an economic cycle, there's a life cycle to a company. And that the life cycle of a company used to be 50 years. It was, at the time he wrote the book, it was trending down to 20. It's now around 16. 16 is the average lifespan of a company on the S&P 500. Okay, so the average company makes it 16 years on the S&P 500 before it either gets gobbled up or falls off. Okay. Under the concept of the firm, these are very simple questions, but what I encourage folks to do is to begin to it's really who are we? The concept of the firm is who are we? And it has a series of questions under that. What do we create? How do we make money? How efficiently do we create? Who are our competitors and how will we grow? Let me show you how you can use this to begin to put together a word picture of the company you're dealing with. Let me say I like to deal with public records. I think there's a lot in public records if you go back and reconcile an audit. Don's asked me before what kind of luck we've had in getting proprietary information out of that. There's sometimes a lot of proprietary information unintentionally in public records if you know what you're looking for and if you look at it from several angles. So I typically deal with the publicly available records that include the income statement, the balance sheet, and the cash flow. And if you put the two of them together, you can get a lot of information plus the little footnotes that come in public records. But on how do we create, what I try to do here is to think about three concepts. So you can create content, you can create distribution, you can create aggregation. And what I try to do here is to think about what is the value you create with each one. So in a disaggregated age, what has happened to newspapers? You basically had distribution and content aggregation stripped away in many ways by Google. Can you articulate what is the value of the content that you are creating? And content, we further divide it along lines of information and entertainment. And what drives the value of information is very different from what drives the value of entertainment. Entertainment tends to depend on blockbusters. Information, you tend to be able to charge for proprietary information that you can't get anywhere else. Okay. We talk about how you make money, and there again, there are three sources we look at there. We look at advertising, point of sale, or subscription, licensing, and syndication. Talk about how that breaks down by medium, is where you get it. You can subdivide that further. And then on how efficiently do we create, look at least these three things and try to look at the cost structure for each of them. So efficiency involves how efficiently you create among with your labor, your supplies, and your overhead. I want to come back to that when we talk about the New York Times because I think there's some important things in there about the New York Times. So using this strategic framework, what I've tried to do with the two papers that I've done is go back in and look at analyzing those public statements for the companies that we've looked at, and also began to look at, for the newspaper industry, what are some of the issues that rise from that. And Dick Foster and I at Yale teamed up to do a paper for Yale back in November. Dick's history is he was a longtime McKinsey consultant, actually wrote the book Innovation and the Attacker's Advantage back in the mid-1980s, about 10 years before Clay Christensen wrote The Innovator's Dilemma. Clay has tended to focus on the technology business. I like Dick because he's dealt with the automotive business, he's dealt with the technology business, he's dealt with the financial services business. He's learning the media business, but always asks provocative questions. He is now up at Yale as a senior fellow up at Yale and doing a whole series of classes and programs on creative destruction. He wrote the book Creative Destruction, Why Companies Underperform, Companies Built to Last Underperform. Back in 2000. So the two of us teamed up to do a co-author, a paper for the Yale conference in November, which was basically designed along the lines of a lot of conferences are designed you know, is there going to be a pay model? How are we going to pay for all the news? And what we did is key off three recently published books. There's Curse of the Mogul, which was printed in fall, and it includes three Columbia University business professors who basically disparage the media conglomerate. There's Losing the News by Alex Jones, done out of Harvard, which I would say is like a personal account of Phil Meyer's vanishing newspaper without the statistics. And then there's Media Ownership and Concentration in America, which came out from Ellie Noem, also at Columbia. He's an economist that's been on a number of FTC and New York regulatory agencies. He takes a pure economist a viewpoint from that. So what we try to do is bring some numbers and some sense to what these three very separate viewpoints had. It was kind of like touching the elephant in three different places. So we said if we pulled it all together, what can we conclude from what these three have done? And what we decided to do was use a pretty simple calculation that a lot of investment analysts use when they figure ROI, which is total shareholder return. So you take the price of a group of publicly owned companies at the beginning, at the end, minus what you pay for them, plus their dividends, and you divide it by the price that you pay for it in the beginning. So you get a total shareholder return from that. And we grouped them according to whether it was traditional news, whether it was a niche information provider, or whether it was a media conglomerate. So traditional news would have been primarily the newspapers. From that, newspaper companies have not diversified as much as others have. Media conglomerates were your Time Warner. It was your Disney's, it was your Viacom's, and then the niche information providers were your Reuters, they were your Pearson's, they were your Walters Kluwer, they were your, I'm trying to think who else was in that, Walters Kluwer, somebody else was in there. But anyway, what you see, and then we put it against the S&P 500. Now, the reason for putting it against the S&P 500 is, again, the notion that Dick Foster has proven over and over again is the lifespan for a traditional company on the S&P 500 has gone down from 50 years to 20 and is trending towards 16 to see how they actually had fared. And if you look at this, I thought there was several interesting things that fell out. Now, of course, Curse of the Media Mogul had used this as an example of saying you do not invest in media conglomerates. They have not been a good deal. Glenn Hubbard at Columbia actually said to me, though, that the only lesson he looked very hard to see why you shouldn't invest with media conglomerates, and the only thing he could figure from this actually fun and well-written book, but a little on the Vanity Fair side, was you shouldn't date high-priced models once you own a media company because you're going to end up with a third and fourth wife. So what we tried to do was break it out along the lines, not just the media conglomerates versus the S&P 500, but to see if anybody had actually matched the performance of the S&P 500. Because what this would say, if you want to avoid creative destruction, you have got to change at least the rate and pace of the S&P 500 or the market itself to avoid being swamped by the destruction at the end of the creative destruction. And, yeah.
How are you defining media?
Well, that's what I said. Traditional news would be the newspaper companies primarily. So it's inside the paper. There are about six or seven that make that up. So it's the total shareholder return. Got it from all that. So in the media conglomerates would be the Time Warners and the Viacoms and the like. And then the niche information providers would be the Reuters and the Kluwers and the Walter Kluwers and that sort of thing.
Okay.
And then the S&P 500 is the S&P 500.
So NBC would be in your blue?
NBC would be in media conglomerates. Yep. That's where NBC would be.
And that's a lot of different things.
It absolutely is, but if you look at the chart, and this is the other thing we found too, even if you take out AOL, Time Warner, what it looks like is that the market really valued, because you see they're the ones that shoot way up there. And then if you look at the 2000-2001, AOL Time Warner was historic because the market cap, which is the value of the shares outstanding, the price of the shares and the value of the times the shares outstanding, the market value of AOL on the day after it was announced, the market value, if you summed them up, would have been roughly 250 or less than that, about $200 billion. The market value given by the market, because they liked that so much, was $350 million. So the market assumed that the joining of AOL Time Warner was going to be so fantastically successful, they added $100 billion market cap to AOL at the time, right after. And, of course, it immediately became apparent it wasn't. And since then, it has trended on down, but has trended back up once the market overcorrected. The market tends to, you know, there's a notion in business school, the market is always efficient. In truth, it's efficient only over the long run. There are wild swings that go on before. If you look at, what was more interesting was to look at traditional news. And so if you look at the S&P, where the S&P is going with that purple note, and then look at the dotted blue line, what's interesting to me is that traditional newspapers did not begin to fall until 2006. And boy, when they did, they fell off the cliff. Mm-hmm. Now, what happened in 2006?
Knight Ridder
and Time Warner both went on the block. And I think that just as the AOL Time Warner caused the stock market to say, is this really all hype or is this really going anyplace, what Knight Ridder and Times Mirror and Tribune did was, until then, you would have the stock market saying, if you own a newspaper, it is a license to print cash. And what it really meant, forced them to say was, we've had 14 years of the internet at this point, and what have newspapers done to accommodate or change?
I'm curious about media conglomerates, and this is just a question.
Yeah.
Where would Microsoft and Google feature?
We did not do Microsoft and Google. They're technology companies. What we were trying, I usually tend to define media companies as somebody who produces content that they're distributing. Google, we discuss this all the time in digital media economics. I would say that Google is both a distributor and an aggregator at this point. And that's the issue. That's the reason.
But what about Microsoft? Microsoft has entities that produce entertainment content and media content.
You could argue that. I was just trying to go with traditional media.
No, I just wanted to say.
Yeah, no, I think you could, and I would be willing to agree with you, too.
I have a question that's slightly not on that, but on the other one. Isn't it true that when companies go on the block, that is for sale, that the price yield is quite different, either high or low, than the general perceived stock price? That is, when a company is either taken public or put up for sale in giant amounts, that the market reconceives the value of that company.
It depends. With I think the big disappointment, you had a bunch of hedge funds who basically forced Knight Ridder into play, mm-hmm. and I think they were mightily disappointed they weren't getting more than they were.
Right, because the market spoke back.
Yeah,
they
right.
They had presented it.
Yeah.
When it was held, it seemed really valuable.
Right.
When it was held out and all the books were open,
yeah.
there was a different story. And I think that's a general trend in markets, because if you're tightly enough held, people have created a certain amount of information poverty.
Well,
it's different than when the whole company is exposed. I would argue,
Paul, it wasn't that the information was tightly held. I would argue that anything goes on the market, it's a chance that you don't just go on business as usual. You say, what is the future of this company?
Okay.
You know, if I'm going to pay X, what is the return I'm going to get? And that caused the combination of both of those two large chains
right.
going on the
right.
market really caused Wall Street to say, what have these companies done to really accommodate the internet? And that's why all of a sudden it just fell off the cliff right there.
Okay.
So from that, what we really looked at, and it pulls a lot from the Ellie Noem's book, that what the internet has done is actually delivered a 1-2-3 punch to traditional newspapers and especially to newspapers. One, it destroyed barriers to entry. Okay? In the past, newspapers were de facto geographic monopolies. It's destroyed that. Second, it diminished pricing leverage across the board. And three, it eliminated entire categories of advertising from that. So we can start with anything in classified you want to talk about. With diminishing pricing leverage, it basically standard that's been used was a television standard, which was more about eyeballs than it was about involvement or anything else like that. So what we did is try to map out a path for renewal, based on a lot of the material that had come in a, from Don's paper called The Rise and Fall of Mass Media back in 1991. And we said these, the most important, there are three things that newspapers need to do to renew themselves. They need to shed legacy costs, reestablish community, and third, build new online advertising from all this. Let's flip forward, don't want to flip back. Let me talk for just a minute about shedding legacy costs. It's interesting because this first one has been picked up a lot and invariably has been picked up by journalists who want to talk about shedding legacy costs. I actually thought shedding legacy costs was one of the more obvious things you could recommend, and I was kind of surprised it was picked up by that. But I think the reason is most journalists have gotten very defensive. They think that it's all about newsroom cost, and what we showed was that the legacy cost for a newspaper is what's really killing you. You know, your production and distribution costs range anywhere from 40 to 50% from that. Now, think for a moment, you're still distributing based on a 200-year-old printing distribution model. What is the single biggest advantage an upstart has in your community? They have no legacy costs. So they can afford to invest in the newsroom. They can afford to invest in a lot of other things. And unfortunately, what's happened with the across-the-board cuts is that you eliminate the newsroom cost. You're basically cutting into your core. When you do your when you do your layoffs, when you do your rollbacks, you're not addressing the real issue. But it's not just a matter of shedding legacy costs, we said. You've got to go back to that second thing I'm very concerned about, doing it and keeping pace with where you're going for the with the future. So that just reminded me, the next slide addresses that. This comes from our friend Donald Shaw. Leaders always try to return to the dominant position. Ironically, I'll commonly assume that only an adjustment is needed. So an adjustment is you're going to shed 5% this year or 10% next year, and you're just going to hold the thing. And so shedding legacy costs involve not just shedding your printing costs, but trying to figure out where your consumer is going, keeping pace with readers' consumption habits, right? And we have the mobility revolution coming. Reestablishing community goes from web pages, the social network, and I think this one is the interesting one, actually, that when I've gotten calls from marketers, they're most fascinated with these last two and have picked up on exactly what this means. And I think because it's a very difficult concept for most editors to grasp. You're used to, if you're a newspaper editor or even a station manager, a news editor, you're used to thinking of a geographic community. And what we've done a lot of work with the Fayetteville Observer, what we discovered when we went into the Fayetteville Observer, is that there are lots of sub-communities that affiliate along, much as magazine readers do, around interest, around the way you perceive yourself. So one of the strongest parts of the website for the Fayetteville Observer is something for military moms or military spouses. Prep sports is another big one. We're working with Whiteville right now, and it looks like religion and prep sports are going to be big ones for them. So it's really difficult to think. If you stop for a minute and think about it, in the era of agenda setting, you put what was important on the front page, and maybe you had, if it was healthcare, there was something on the lifestyle section or something in the sports section about what particularly affected those communities. But now you've got to assume that people never even hit the webpage. They may go straight into the social network that they're tied into on that newspaper. And it causes you to think very differently about how you section and resection information and distribute it and deliver it. It's a very different challenge, I think, for editors today to partake in reestablishing community when it was given to you as long as you were de facto geographic monopoly. And then the other notion is the notion of building new revenue streams, and I want to talk about that in just a minute. And this really builds on the a lot of the work that started over here in the 1970s when Maxwell Combs articulated the theory of relative constancy. And before I talk about that, I want to just say this comes from PricewaterhouseCoopers. Before she left, Barbara spent a lot of money and got us PricewaterhouseCoopers. They actually come out once a year in June, and they're a real good barometer of where things are trending within the a good resource is down in the library. This one is a little getting, this one looks at, I think it was 2009, came out in 2009, so it's last year's. But it is down in the library, and Stephanie, you can just go get it, right? And take a look at it. This has a nice growth trend. They look back over the last decade and also give you a nice growth trend. And what you can see is that just on traditional revenue streams is projected to be up quite a bit, and most of that is coming out of either the television or out of the internet and the mobile wired realm, not over newspapers, which are projected to be down, or any of the others. The theory of relative constancy basically holds, it was articulated by Maxwell Combs first as a theory, and he basically had the notion that what we paid to consume media as consumers held relatively constant, a relative constant portion of our income, and what the percent of companies were willing to pay for advertising was a relatively constant percent of GDP. Okay, what's very interesting, and he built this off a saying, I guess, or some quote made by Charles Scripps, you may know this better than I do, in which he postulated, even though we've had the introduction of all these new media, that the percent paid on advertising has still been relatively the same. What's been real interesting in the last anywhere from 5 to 10 years, is the notion that there's something called below-the-line advertising. So what Max was measuring was above the line, so that would be your traditional advertising sources. There is a whole range of things called below-the-line advertising that's only begun to be measured in the last 10 years. And it includes everything from the coupons that you would get in the mail versus what would appear in a medium, to that you got handed out at the mall, that you got, it's just a whole range of below-the-line advertising things that you never, it's promotions that stores would do, buy one, get two free. And that has grown, it's been, during the time it's been tracked by both Jupiter and by Winterberry, that has been growing, by some estimates it's almost double the size of traditional advertising. But it's also very interesting if you start thinking about the ability that you have, if you recreate community around social networks, to actually use couponing. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I get inundated with coupons that I just routinely kill out of my inbox. But if you can figure out a way to target those in a different environment, it becomes a very different sort of thing. So. We're in the process of taking a look at trying to update this using the below the line and seeing whether, in fact, the revenue pie has actually is bigger than what we think, and then whether there's an opportunity to take advantage of that as traditional newspaper advertising continues to go down, because I think that's the key going forward. And then the answer again, too, is if you want to look at how fast you need to be changing, what we tried to do was give newspapers out there a notion of how do you gauge whether I'm changing fast enough. It's very, very hard. Dick Foster talked about the four stages of the company. The last one is cultural lock-in. And if you think about it, the hardest thing in the world for any of us to do is to kill something off, especially if it's a legacy. He tells a wonderful story about how Gordon Moore and Andy Grove realized that the DRAM unit up in Seattle needed to be shut down. It was the company was losing tons of money. Because the Japanese were producing it much better and much less, more efficiently and much, much cheaper, and selling it much, much cheaper. And it, even so, with Gordon Moore having hypothesized the notion of the Moore's Law, which is, you know, the transmitter kind of, what you can put on a transmitter changes every 2 years or so. It took the two of them actually going up to Seattle to shut it down. They kept sending people back up there. They'll say, shut it down, we gotta shut it down. Nobody wants to kill anything off, so it just continues to go. And their point is that unless you deal with the change in a proactive fashion, what it does is it saps the attention of the management, and it saps away the cost, the money you potentially would have for reinvestment to change from all of that. So you need to change. If the S&P is changing at every 16 years, you need to change it about 6% to stay ahead of the market on all of that. And then the other thing I wanted to briefly talk about was a paper I did for Duke called A Nonprofit Model for the New York Times with a question mark, and I want to emphasize the question mark. I actually got booked for a public radio station where she said, so, Professor Abernathy, I understand you think there should be a nonprofit model for the New York Times. In fact, what I wanted to do was take a look at four nonprofit alternatives. first took this job, I can't tell you the number of people who said the nonprofit is the answer, and there are a whole bunch of issues with nonprofit that are the same that have to do with profit in many ways. So the four things I looked at was the establishment of a $5 billion endowment to support the news department. That came courtesy of the people who managed the Yale endowment in the New York Times op-ed page, and they recommended $5 billion to support the $200 billion New York Times newsroom department. The second was foundational support for a portion of journalism, sort of like foreign coverage or cultural coverage. The third was purchased by an educational institution. And then finally, the was sale of the Times to an angel investor. And of course, at the time, everybody thought the angel would be Bloomberg. It turned out to be quite different. And I also wanted to kind of make folks stop and look and see what made the New York Times different. And one of the things that has made the New York Times different is that they have managed more skillfully than any publication probably ever in the history or any to charge you for the circulation for your subscription to the print edition. And they did that very skillfully by hiding the price they were charging you. They hided they managed to get it very inelastic, because they got you back in the mid-90s to start charging your New York Times subscription to a credit card. And over the last 10 years, they have raised your national print subscription from $189 to $800. And nobody knows. At the same time, they've primarily grown subscription. Nobody knows, because if you think about it, you get billed four times a year and you don't notice it. It gets mixed in with every one of your other credit card things. The Wall Street Journal was not nearly smart enough, and they kept you paying with cash, and they're still stuck around $200 a year for a print subscription. Now, irony of ironies, nobody ever says a business makes a smart decision. How much does it cost you to go online and get the New York Times? Absolutely nothing. So when everybody says, oh, is this risky that they're going to start charging next year, they've got to do something. They have got a huge amount of revenue at stake. It's roughly about $700 million that's at stake. They've also got a huge amount in advertising at stake, because what they're pricing the amount on the web for is 1/40 of what they get in the print edition. So they've really got to move to do something. And if you notice the other, they're about the only newspaper that gets a licensing and syndication fee that's anywhere near that. So, you know, what's riskier and more puzzling is that it's been over 10 years to figure out they've got to do something in the online arena to start capturing some value, because they're simply using this and eroding it as it goes. On the cost side, this was one of the ahas, I think, for most people who came back to address the legacy side. Everybody talks about the really expensive newsroom in the New York Times. In fact, the newsroom of the New York Times is not really the problem. It's 50 to 60% of their costs are locked up in printing and distribution of a national newspaper over the next 2 years. Now, usually you take on debt to do things like acquire another company or something like that, and everybody automatically assumes it was that really bad $1.1 billion acquisition they made of the Boston Globe. But no, that's not what the debt came from. The debt came from in 2002, 2003, 2004. They bought back $3 billion worth of stock when it was $50 a share. Now, why do you buy back stock? Your own stock, you buy it back because you say, I've looked around the country, I haven't seen any other place I can invest. Best investment is in me. So they had $1 billion coming due in debt, and on top of everything else, they had, this one is coming through. Nope. They also had a liability of $800 million for pension liabilities too that are out there. They managed to get out of the debt. It was due last May. They managed to get out of the debt by selling the building, selling the headquarters that they were in for $250,000. They had actually paid, I think, $250 million. They'd actually paid $500 million for it. So they've sold the headquarters, now renting their headquarters back. And they got a loan from somebody south of the border named Carlos Slim. And their original debt was coming due. They've been paying 4%, and Carlos stepped up and said, I'll give you the other $250 at 14%. So.
Oh.
Carlos is sitting there with a ticking bomb, and one of the things that he also has the right to convert the debt into preferred shares, which if the company goes bankrupt, he's first in line before anybody else to get it. Yeah.
They also sold off the broadcast division, which was
yes.
They had a cash cow for them.
Well, actually, that's interesting, Jim. But what they did is they sold off the broadcast division, they sold off the magazine division, they sold off a ton of the newspapers, and what they did is take that money and buy the stock at $50 a share. I mean, it's like you're stripping your company. It's the original version of a cash cow, except why would you invest back in your company when you're doing that? So, anyway, so as you can see, the valuation had gone way, 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 way down. At one point, I think it was actually around $3. I think today it's somewhere around 11 or 12. Somebody was telling me in class yesterday that day before yesterday, right? There was a rumor Carlos Slim was going to buy the rest of the New York Times, and it actually spiked, but then it settled right back down when they realized Carlos doesn't need to buy it. You can just wait. He's got plenty of time. And the other problem here is with Carlos holding the preferred shares, what angel is going to step up and actually help you there? Carlos. Yes, exactly. And then there's the micro issues are there in the cycle or cyclone, and I think you can see when they've got all of their revenue tied to the print product, they are definitely in a cyclone, not in any pure cycle. The problem has been, if you've listened to their analyst reports, they still tend to talk about what a cycle they're in, and things are picking back up. Things are picking back up means their advertising only went down 20% instead of 30% from last year. The problem with the endowment, it came from our friends at Yale, $5 billion. That was right about the time he managed to steer the Yale endowment down 30%. So, you know, if you have a prudent man rule, which is you only take off 5% of the endowment, that's not going to protect you from wild swings, and you need a lot more than $5 billion. To do that, there's several other problems with it. What person or foundation is going to actually put together $5 billion? And then the third one is, does the newsroom of the New York Times in this age really need to have 1,200 people and be carrying $200 million? Is there not a better way? And among others, the New Yorker has posed, what is the role of the New York Times newsroom when in a world of all the news that's fit to print? Is it that you have to produce every bit of the news, or are you the ultimate purveyor of looking what's out there and aggregating it and repurposing a large portion of it? The second is foundation. That one is actually one of the more interesting ones. I think it opens you up to a certain amount of infighting inside the newsroom or how you cordon something off, but you could conceivably look at a model similar with Council on Foreign Relations. And that's the one I think has gotten the most pickup of this in terms of the blogosphere of what people have thought was the most interesting. The third is the education notion of you put it in a Harvard or you let a Columbia University take over it like they have the Harvard Business Review and you put it out. The problem is you've still got the legacy costs that are coming on there and declining profits, so how long does it become a for-profit enterprise for a non-profit enterprise such as Harvard? And then the last is something called the L3C, where you actually apply to say, I'm really delivering a public good. This was one of the things that's been introduced by, I think, the congressman whose district includes the Baltimore Sun. It does not stand a lot of chance of getting through, but the issue with an L3C is why would you want to do an L3C if you've still got 50% of your costs are sitting there in a legacy institution and you've done nothing to really build up your revenues from all of that. So where I come across on not-for-profit is I think in a very strategic way it can be beneficial. As we're going through a period of creative destruction, I think there will be market failures. They're likely to be in areas like state public policy and things like that. And this quote came off of CNN Money from Richard Sikloss, who had actually worked at the New York Times. I think that you're going to have news organizations that are for profit. The problem with the not-for-profit and supporting the New York New York Times as it currently is, you do nothing but prolong the inevitable. If you support a $200 million newsroom or support an institution that's still taking 50% of its cost and legacy without going to something else. So I'd much rather see the non-for-profit aimed at really covering a market failure rather than our potential market failure rather than supporting something that ultimately you do a disservice to. The McCormick grant came from the McCormick Foundation. They have given two other grants, one to the University of Kentucky and the University of West Virginia. They're working on coming up with the technology to help rural newspapers make it into the 21st century. Our mandate is to help them come up with business models to make it into the 21st century. It's really been a fun project. Everybody here from leadership is working on it in some way, shape, matter, or form. And so what we've basically done has been Bain back in the good days of trying to go in and not talk about just cost containment or what they need to do, but also to look at ways they can grow revenue and hopefully come up with models that can be used for newspapers across the country. McCormick would love for whatever we find from Whiteville and Washington, Little Washington, and from the Wilkesboro paper to be able to, you may have the wrong one there, but anyway, that for it to be applicable to a paper in New Mexico or Montana or wherever lands. And so what we try to do is to focus in each one of the papers on one specific area of the work done for Yale. So with Washington recently cut back from 7 publishing days to 6. There's some indication they probably should only be doing 3. They've done absolutely nothing on the website to make that transition, so we're trying to help them figure out what the appropriate number of days for publishing it is and how they build up the online presence there. Wilkesboro did not even have a web page until last year. While they have been sleeping, a design firm actually put something out called gowilkes.com that was designed simply to show how you could design your own web page. And they started putting up the calendar and the community events up there and have been able to build a nice little side business off the advertising that they've got. It's actually heavily trafficked. They also have competition from a Christian radio station in the area that started the social network that also charges for personals on the social network. So while Wilkesboro has been continuing to put out community newspapers, so we want to try to help them figure out how they make that first step over into the online world. Real first step. And then with Whiteboard, we're focusing on, they have a very interesting, vibrant, small website that gets 2,000 uniques a day. They do Twitter just in time live news feeds to do updates. We did a little button. We've used the Fred Reichel thing, which you recommend to a friend or neighbor, and they have a quite strong presence online as well as in print down there. So we're trying to help them figure out how they generate new revenue streams for Whiteboard. We're also doing a brainstorming session with at least two of the papers during the North Carolina Press Association. We've done advertiser interviews, we've done reader interviews, one-on-ones, and we've done online surveys in all of the markets. And have also done a strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats, SWOT analysis for each of these, and we're going to sit down and brainstorm and do that. One of the things I wanted to wanted to mention was one of the neat things is not only building on the research of Don and Phil and Maxwell McCombs here, but the neat research that's actually going on by students in both in the leadership class. Last spring, Lucia Parker, senior honor student, actually did the surveying down in the Fayetteville Observer that got us started, and really talked about it. It was actually quite an interesting survey. She found out, for instance, that fully a third of the people that use the website at the Fayetteville Observer never pick up the print edition. That's actually a very interesting finding. You would find it hard to believe, but most people have been assuming the same people that use the website were the people that were using the print. A third is a lot of that. And so we're trying to gauge that now with the other papers, too, that are going on. Kevin Kiley is doing No News for Breakfast, Identifying the Emerging Adults' News Habits. He's focusing on how many, Kevin, 26 right now?
23 right now, hopefully 30.
Going up, he's doing one-on-ones, and so it'll be the first round of qualitative research. Don and I have been talking on occasion about how great it would be if we could, as a as a school, begin researching the media habits over a long period of time of every entering freshman here. The only study that I'm aware of that anybody has done that looks at the various generations is Deloitte. The problem with the Pew is everybody gets kind of mashed in together. Kevin's taking a valiant first start on qualitative research there. Andrew,
yep, is that emerging adults you're studying or emerging news outlets?
No, emerging adults.
So what's the age bracket for them? That's a new term for me, emerging adults. I'm going to try that on some kids.
It's people between the ages of 18 and 25. They're the first segment of the millennial generation.
I got you. Okay.
Andrew Garrick, who's my TA and has a undergraduate degree in economics and math, has decided to put his multimedia skills to work, and he is tackling the theory of relative constancy, trying to make it something that's both approachable and applicable to the McCormick newspapers. He's going to have his multimedia project done before he leaves to move on to the rest of things in life. And he's also trying to include the below the line and reconcile that in his own with his own economic twist. Jed is doing Wired for the Future, Creative Destruction and Continual Renewal at the Associated Press. Has spent a good deal of time in both the Fayetteville Observer and the Charlotte Observer. We're debating whether he should also look at Washington, which is paying a huge amount to Associated Press right now, which we discovered when we signed the confidentiality agreements, Don, and they showed us their books. So what is the value of AP? Again, that's what we keep coming back. What is the value that you're offering in a disaggregated age? And then finally, Sam, who's not here but sick today, and along with Janine and Annika and David, are all taking a swipe at the newspaper readers in a digital age. Have done both the online research as well as the one-on-ones of newspaper readers, where we actually sat down with a list of about 35, 40 questions that we've asked everybody going down, and have some interesting initial responses of what can be done, I think, with both advertising and with readership. I want to end with a Don Shaw. Creative leaders, once again, are needed to find ways to locate loyal audiences and use technology to find ways to research these and old and new audiences from 1991. How prescient it was. And then, of course, the one thing I could actually agree with Ellie Nome when he says the likelihood the structure of this medium will remain as before is absolutely nil. So we need creative ideas for all.
If you go back to one of your first slides, the creative destruction, where you had a list of six or seven things, you know the slides, can you tell about one of them, how to make a problem? This is the very first move. I'm just curious about a certain question.
I think that is the point that Dick Foster would make. You've got to change at 6% a year if you're a company, a rate of 6% a year. That doesn't mean you do 6% each year.
Yeah.
Some companies do. He talks about three kinds of change, Don. He talks about incremental change, which is something that we do all the time, which is like we add a course, we drop a course, we do something. He talks about substantial change, which he defines as laying off 10% or more of your workforce, and then there's transformative change. So, and I think what we're seeing, unfortunately, from a lot of the news organizations is substantial change without the transformation that goes with it.
This struck me earlier, for those not as invested in the print world, that virtuous circle is really monopoly.
Yeah.
Monopoly created that.
Yeah.
And what really complicates it in terms of what you just said is when you talk to print people because they haven't competed, they don't understand that concept of competing.
Yeah.
They're in a world that where it's the power company.
Yeah.
Instead of, you, normally, I'm not talking about every paper, but your average metro paper who hasn't had competition, the managers that are sitting in there, whether they're on the news side, the advertising side, whatever side, have no idea how to compete.
Don't you think that's also applicable to many university curriculum?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's a, you know, I've been on both sides. I can say I'm bilingual, so let me just say that. I think that's absolutely right, especially on the advertising side. That's why it's going to be so difficult to get print advertising through this. They've been used to being order takers, a little more than order takers. You sat there, we announced whatever your price increase was, you went there and you got it. And one of the things we're picking up from the advertisers is, I just want to be thanked.
Yeah.
Nobody's ever thanked me. it's that monopoly notion of, I'm here, you've got to advertise with me, and you don't laugh. Even if you're in Wilkesboro, you got the Christian radio station if you want to find a mate, and you've got the Go Wilkes if you want to do something else.
Yeah. I was going to say, a lot of this is rooted in about a half century worth of organizational literature about developing loyalty through third-party recommendations, things like that. I don't know. Are you really familiar with like a lot of the more recent data that they've been turning out? Where it's seeming the price sensitivity now is actually really the key determinant in commerce, and that's not just with media, but commerce in general.
But if you're the New York Times and you can hide it, you can still get by with it. I mean, that's one of the things of being able to. We talk about pricing a lot in digital media economics, and there are a whole range of ways to price, and one of the ones is value-based pricing, but you can also, you've got to be able to attribute what the value is that you're charging for.
Yeah, and as a follow-up to that, and I guess maybe possibly even related, because with that PricewaterhouseCooper data on the projected earnings, I know at least up to the third quarter last year, they were well below those projections in terms of ad spending across the board. Mm-hmm. And I think that might be reflective of that. I think that, do you think that's something that's just more of a business cycle?
So are you talking about pricing sensitivity for consumers or for advertisers?
For both.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I mean, so do you think this is something that's more of a business cycle issue, or is there something else going on here?
I think it's probably a business cycle thing. I mean, you're going to try to get the best price that you absolutely can from all of that, you're really going to question what the value is you're getting out of print right now.
So, and then going back to the slide that Dr. Shaw was talking about, the destruction one.
Mm-hmm.
If the destruction to actual creation is occurring,
mm-hmm.
if the price sensitivity issue really is something of, significance, wouldn't that mean that the free information that would be put out there really be what would do a lot of these online papers on?
I think it depends. We talk about when you're going to charge for content. Are you talking about charging for content?
Mm-hmm.
I think there are very few that are going to be able to charge for content. But listen, I also want to make this point. For most newspapers, circulation was a loss leader in order to get the advertising. So if you just are going to look at charging for content, there are going to be very few places, say Bloomberg, say maybe the Wall Street Journal, say a few places like that where you can charge for proprietary information, or if you're Bloomberg, for analytics that you can't get anywhere else. So it's kind of, you go up a scale. One of the things I use in class that I love is, you know how Reuters were started? People were sending the homing pigeons across the English Channel between the Netherlands in the 1950s. I mean, you could charge for immediacy then. It's very hard to charge for immediacy now. By the same token, it's very hard to charge for breaking news right now. It's very hard to charge for some of this hyperlocal. That's one of the things I think is a fallacy here of a lot of the work that's being done in other institutions is the notion you just got to be local. You've got to rebuild community. And you've got to be able to offer to the advertiser a valuable community they're willing that they're willing to pay for. Now, in some kind of instances, consumers are going to be willing to pay for it, but it's going to be very hard to ever get that. I think the 15%, I mean, let's just be realistic. The last 200 years, you haven't paid a lot for the information you've got. So, you know, Rupert can stomp up and down and say, you know, content is not only king, it's emperor. But what does that mean?
Let's see how to phrase this question. And in its creative destruction, I learned about creative destruction about 10 years ago because we put it in a state of the South report that I was doing.
And did you get as many emails as I did about it?
And Dr. Ed Bishop, who was a big time economist, who did the, you know, was the head of Lyndon Johnson's study of rural America and all that, was the one that helped to see this. But we applied the analysis to whole communities, to a rural economy, that kind of thing. What I'm hearing you're doing is applying it to an individual company.
Right.
And I'm wondering whether we can expect a company to do creative destruction or whether it's just incapable of it, except at a modest level, and that what we ought to be thinking about is the broader sense of what companies live and then what takes their place within
right.
the same field or within journalism.
Yes, I'm applying it to very specific companies. Let me answer that. And the track record would say very few companies, once they lived out
right.
their lifespan, make it, okay?
Yeah.
But companies do. Intel's reinvented
right.
itself 3 times. Apple is, you can argue Apple has reinvented itself numerous times. But the odds are against an individual company doing this. I do think that's exactly what I think. The broader issue is what is the role that the newspaper industry was performing? How does that get reinvented and carried forth in another way? Yeah.
He's performing.
Okay.
I would be interested if you could talk a little bit more about your conception of community, because the way I hear you talking about community really is more about lifestyle segmentation, marketing terms, things of that nature that I think are really undercutting a lot of the values that we traditionally think of in terms of the value of journalism in a civic community. And one of my concerns is that I believe there's going to be new models for information companies, but whether that supports journalism or at least the journalism that's valuable to a civic community or not is a concern to me. And I haven't really heard you address what type of journalism this is going to support, if it's going to support journalism at all, or if it's going to support, you know, more market segmentation, lifestyle type of information, things of that nature.
Yeah, no, I thought I had done it, and let me state again, I think there are going to be market failures, and most likely they're going to be on the public policy level, where it's just to the notion of what is it you're willing to pay. There are not a lot of people willing to pay for some of the news. Is that a public good that needs to be supported in some way? There are a lot of arguments going on about that. I don't know ultimately where we're going to be 10 years from now. I see that that's going to be an issue over the next 5 to 10 years. I don't know where we come out of that, but what I'm also saying is I think it's not going to be solely on the basis of somebody wanting to pay for that content, so there's got to be some other way. The benefit of the past was you were able to bundle all these other things around it that then got to pay for. But I mean, I think that's an issue in very specifically coming home, because you're having the loss of dominance of things like the NNO or the Charlotte Observer that would have performed some of those trendings on the state and regional level in the past. Yeah, Tom?
So I agree with you about the community things, and I just wanted to build off on, I also agree with you. I think two books that are kind of interesting about that, and then I have a question. Is, of course, Benedict Anderson's Imagine Communities, in which he claims newspapers create nations, or people that can't see each other regularly. So some that you just have to abstract from that to see what parts of those functions might be done from the civic. The other is Thomas Bennett's sort of sociological survey of communities. Because they talk about, they're conceived not as markets but of interest groups. And that doesn't mean that markets aren't communities.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean that markets are an exclusive definition of community. Then my question is, suppose I wanted to make a living on the internet. Suppose I realized that the value of an ad changed radically depending on who saw it and how they saw it and when they saw it. And I would pay different amounts based on that ad. And I would just find some way to get lots of information that was on the internet and present it to people in some order that was really useful to them. And then I would put a sort of unobtrusive ad that was kind of related to that search that people would have bid for. Is that a pretty good business model?
The point I didn't make is one of the things we're talking about are new sources for revenue that I've made in the paper is that one of the problems you've had is first the pricing for ads were basically based on, for newspapers, on an eyeball
right.
or a TV sort of environment, totally discounting the involvement. But secondly, banner ads were really just like taking the old display ads and putting
right,
them in a new
exactly.
medium.
We've
only had one new form of advertising so far invented off the internet, and that's search advertising.
Right.
Google has a good portion of that, but that's mostly national search. I think there are lots of wonderful opportunities to begin, but you've got to think, again, differently about the community. You've got to have an advertising person who's actually thinking about serving the client instead of just taking the order to come in and say, I can bundle this community this way and charge something for it. I mean, we're thinking about down in Whiteville, and actually in Washington, too, Annika had this idea. You know, newspaper tends to think of the news they printed today. There's a wonderful opportunity on the web to become the archive and the repository for the entire community. And the realtors have told us the only reason they advertise in the newspaper anymore is because the person who's selling the house likes to see the little paper, that it does absolutely no good. They get, so it's pretty bad when somebody figures out that that value proposition doesn't work. We know what happened to Help Wanted when people figured out it didn't work. I mean, is there a way to put together this community archive that you can then sell to the realtor again for anybody who's looking for anything from, you know, what the school scores are to what the crime rate is to what the price of the real estate is in that market, yeah.
The way we're dealing with the paper I'm helping is we've got to deal with the, is it MLS?
Yeah.
Put it on the paper's website.
Mm-hmm.
And then sell the MLS
mm-hmm.
as well as provide that sort of service.
Mm-hmm.
So you do an upsell. The paper and the web with their own information to some sort of group.
Yeah.
I have a recommendation for you to consider in your thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of talking about rebuilding community, to think more about connecting emerging communities. It's quite different.
Yep. No, I think they're both, that's a rebuild or connect. I think they're both possibility. I think the neat thing that goes back to it is that this is a time of immense opportunity. I mean, it's called creative destruction for a reason. There are lots of opportunities right now, but it really is very hard for us. I mean, I think we tend to, those of us who've known something else, we have the Chicken Little approach. The real key is to try to focus on the one or two things that you can begin to look at that will begin to make sense right now.
We have time for one more question, and we want the last question.
Well, thank you very much for asking. For anybody, we did kill a few trees, but anybody who would like a copy of the paper is up here, so you don't have to.
Don't worry.